Thank you very much again for joining in today. A very important and relevant topic in day-to-day practice, that's on acquired coagulation, DIC. So we have, Dr. Sujata Sharma has kindly agreed to, volunteer and moderate today's session. So unfortunately, there's some technical error and I think she'll be with us soon. But as usual, we'll have, two components. We'll have the didactic, which is going to be done by Dr. Purvi Karakia and also by Dr. Shweta Bansal, and then followed by case presentations by the fellows from Sion Hospital. We have a panel of experts today to be discussing these cases. So I'll just try to introduce our panelists for today. We have our Dr. Rashmi Dalvi, ma'am. So I don't think she needs introduction to this audience. Ma'am is currently the president of PSIOP Asia, and also she heads the Department of Pediatrics at the Bombay Hospital. She also is a pediatric hematologist associated with SRCC Children's Hospitals in Mumbai. We have an expert from Mumbai again, Dr. Shehnaz Kodajit. Good afternoon, ma'am, and thank you for your time for joining today. As we all know, ma'am is a senior consultant in hematology and transfusion medicine at PD Hinduja Hospital, and she's got an enormous experience of more than three decades in thrombosis and bleeding. So thank you very much, ma'am, for finding the time and interacting with us today.
Thank you.
Dr. Shweta Bansal is senior consultant at HN Reliance Hospital in Mumbai, and she also is a visiting faculty at Sion Hospital. Dr. Purvi Karakia, who is going to take the first didactic, she is a senior consultant at Apollo Hospital in Navi Mumbai, and she also visits Sion Hospital. And we have got Neena Fade and Dr. Lekha Parekh. They are both residents at Sion Hospital who is going to be presenting the cases today. So as usual, we'll go with the didactic today. Now, before we start, there has been, we have been very fortunate that we have got this platform through ECHO, which we have been using every week. And one of the observations which has been made that, these are supposed to be interactive sessions. And, unfortunately, I see all the students have their videos off. So this is one of the observations which has been made. It's very difficult and also not, I would say, fair that so much of hard work goes in to prepare the sessions and we just keep on talking to the blank screens in front of us. So my request to each one of you is please, especially the students who have logged in, to please keep your videos on. And this is now, it was a request every week. Now I have to be very, strict about it, because I think we have been told by ECHO that if it doesn't happen, they will discontinue the support for these sessions, and I think I don't want that to happen. So my request is please keep your videos on, and as we have been doing all these weeks, we can chat the questions in the chat box, or you can raise your hand and ask a question also. That's absolutely fine. So over to you, Purvi. So once Dr. Sujata joins in, then we can ask her to moderate the session for today.
Joined in. Yeah, I already joined in. I think am I audible, Dr. Sunil?
Yes, we can hear you, Dr. Sujata. Sorry, we kind of tried to start before you. So what do you know to conduct this today's session, please?
Fine. Yeah, thank you, Dr. Sunil. And I thank the full IIP chapter and Dr. Manglani and Dr. Sunil to invite us to present this very important and day-to-day problems with coagulation. And I want to share our experience with all our residents and fellows, so that they get updated with this knowledge. First of all, I say sorry because we got late to join. And I think you've already introduced our expertise, panelist, and the didactic lecturer faculties. And we can now straight away go to the didactic presentation by Dr. Purvi Karakia on etiology pathogenesis about acquired coagulation. So back to Purvi to start with her didactic lecture.
Yes. Bill, the screen sharing.
Yeah.
I have been given the really tough job of describing the pathophysiology of coagulation, which is quite complex, as we know, and the etiology and clinical features associated with acquired coagulopathy. I hope I do justice, and the residents and the students kind of clear some concepts which have not been understood. So this would be a 15-minute talk where I'll try to cover an overview of the physiology of hemostasis, pathogenesis of acquired coagulopathy, the various etiologies or common clinical scenarios in children, clinical presentation, a little bit more on DIC and its differential diagnosis. So as we all know that hemostasis is quite a complex process which occurs in a beautiful physiological synchrony in our body. And it is quite complex in vivo, but what I'll try and explain y'all, it's basically four simple steps. So when there is a vessel injury or an endothelial damage, the first step is reacting by the vessel wall spasm or vasoconstriction. This in turn triggers platelet activation. That is the subendothelial matrix, the collagen which is present on the damaged vessel subendothelial matrix interacts with the receptors on the platelet. In turn leads to platelet activation, platelet aggregation, and this formation of a platelet plug. As we all know, these two steps comprise of primary hemostasis. This platelet plug forms a nidus for the coagulation cascade to go ahead, and that is triggered by tissue factor, again from the damaged vessel wall. And coagulation cascade is nothing but inactive proteases getting converted into active proteases with the help of cofactors. And ultimately, there's generation of thrombin, which increases to 100-fold by a positive feedback mechanism. This converts fibrinogen to fibrin, leads to a clot formation. So this clot formation is stabilized by factor 13. So the fibrin monomers get polymerized and a stabilized clot is formed. But also beautifully in our body, we have to limit this clot. Otherwise, there will be widespread coagulation going on. So we need to limit the site of the clot formation. And this is by the physiological antithrombotic mechanisms, which are already present in our body. So antithrombin 3, the protein C pathway, and the tissue factor pathway. This limits the spread of the clot. Once the clot has formed, it has to eventually dissolve. So how does that take place? By a process called fibrinolysis, which is by plasmin, which is the enzyme present. It kind of degrades these fibrin, interlinked, cross-linked fibrin to fibrin degradation products. So ultimately, the end stage of hemostasis would be localization and dissolution of the clot. So what starts like a platelet party going on and then ends with thrombin generation is quite complex, but we should try and simplify it. Now, moving on to acquired coagulopathy, these are a set of medical conditions where there is decreased clotting factors, inhibition of coagulation, or excessive activity of the fibrinolytic system. So because of which the child presents with bleeding. It can be any one of the components of your coagulation system. So the vessel wall and connective tissue, your platelets, and your coagulation cascade. So common things will be a quantitative, qualitative defect in platelets can lead to unexplained bleeding. Acquired causes, some of the common causes we know is ITP. If it goes into something like a chronic ITP, these are also predisposed for coagulopathies. Vessel wall defects or connective tissue defects, which are acquired scurvy. Acquired coagulopathies, DIC, vitamin K deficiency, thrombotic microangiopathies, advanced liver disease, renal disease, drugs, and acquired factor deficiencies. So moving on to a very important subset of these acquired coagulopathies is disseminated intravascular coagulation. So how does the International Society of Thrombosis and Hemostasis take a definition or a stand on DIC? So it's defined as an acquired syndrome characterized by intravascular activation of coagulation with a loss of localization arising from different causes. So there has to be something acquired. It can originate from and cause damage to the microvascular vasculature, which if sufficiently severe can produce organ dysfunction. So to simplify this, it is an acquired disorder. There has to be an underlying trigger, an external trigger. It's characterized both by hemorrhage as well as microvascular thrombosis. It is a secondary process. There is systemic activation of the whole coagulation cascade leading to tissue damage from various underlying causes. Other names are also consumptive coagulopathy or acquired afibrinogenemia. So to make it even further simple, there's widespread clotting. So it's not localized clotting because of intravascular activation of the coagulation cascade because of a secondary external factor which is present. It may be sepsis, maybe trauma, or maybe drug-induced. This widespread clotting leads to microvascular thrombosis, which causes organ ischemia and end organ damage. And because of so much clotting, there is in turn depletion of the clotting factors and platelets, which further leads to bleeding. And there is an imbalance between both the mechanisms. So there's also a consumption of clotting factors and platelets and microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, ischemic organ damage, which is responsible for the mortality. And these cause thrombotic manifestations. Fibrinolysis and consumption of clotting proteins as well as the platelets cause the bleeding manifestations. There are various pathophysiological subtypes in DIC. This is important to understand because we target the therapy depending on how the patient is or what is the underlying cause and which pathophysiological subtype is he falling into. So if there is excess of fibrinolysis, the patient presents as a bleeder, which is typically seen in our sepsis, massive, say, traumatic brain injury, etc. And when the patient behaves more towards a coagulation type or an organ failure type, so there is a microvascular thrombosis, this subtype will have problems related to coagulation. So there will be end organ or organ failure type. There are certain subtypes typically seen in some pediatric malignancies like APML, ALL, where there is hyperfibrinolysis or there is a massive bleeder type of a patient. So this one we have to be vigilant for when we are dealing with so that we know which subtype requires replacement therapy. And then there is an intermediate or a fourth subset, which is an asymptomatic, something like a chronic DIC picked up only on the lab parameters. So this is a huge list of all the various causes of childhood DIC. It ranges from infections, viral, bacterial, fungal sepsis, malaria, massive traumatic injury, brain injury, crushed injury, burns, malignancies, typically APML, ALL, microangiopathic or vascular disorders like Casabac-Merritt syndrome, GI disorders and neonatal causes, asphyxia, respiratory distress, meconium aspiration, NEC. Some of the common clinical scenarios we see, first on the list is sepsis, trauma, malignancies, vascular disorders, toxins, snake bites. This is a typical skin or a fang mark in a child who had recently come with a snake bite. They go into DIC, need to be monitored before they set into complications of DIC. Immunological disorders, hemolytic transfusion reactions, transplant rejection, and severe allergy. So what are the differential diagnoses of DIC? Dysfibrinogenemia, subset of thrombotic microangiopathies, that is a TTP and HUS, which we are going to discuss in the cases. Child abuse must be high on alert because they can come with bruising at different stages. Heparin-induced thrombocytopenia and COVID-associated coagulopathy, which we cannot miss out in these days. So this we will discuss in our cases. Just a little bit on thrombotic microangiopathy, that the underlying pathophysiology in this disorder is endothelial injury or endothelial dysfunction. This causes thrombocytopenia associated with multi-organ failure, and it's a life-threatening, potentially 20% mortality. What is the characteristic pathophysiology or the pathological finding? There is platelet-rich microthrombi in small vessels. And these are classically seen in children with HUS, TTP, chemotherapy-induced. Certain drugs can cause TMA, especially immunosuppressants like cyclosporin, tacrolimus, infections, ischemia, reperfusion injury. And this is highlighted by microangiopathic hemolytic anemia in association with thrombocytopenia. It is distinct from DIC. It's not much of a hypercoagulable state. So just to differentiate the pathophysiology between HUS, atypical HUS and TTP, everything is an endothelial dysfunction leading to a TMA, which is triggered by something. So typically the Shiga toxin induced HUS, it triggers systemic inflammation and endothelial damage leading to thrombotic microangiopathy. Atypical HUS is triggered, is a diagnosis by exclusion, and it is triggered by complement activation. Whereas TTP is due to deficiency of a metalloprotease present in the blood, Adams TS13. It may be congenital or acquired. And this leads to persistence of ultra-large multimers of von Willebrand factor, which lead to deposition in the areas of high shear stress. So that's the capillaries and the arterioles. So small vessel microthrombosis. Typically etiology in children, conditions causing TMAs, HUS, TTP, drugs, post-transplant scenario, malignancy, and some autoimmune disorders. So based on all these things, what is most important while we're evaluating a child with a suspected acquired coagulopathy is quickly look whether the child is well looking or sick looking, take a detailed history, whether there is an onset, duration and progress of any symptoms, particularly fever, if there is any diarrheal illness, whether there is any history of recent medications, the site of petechiae bruises, whether it's more predominant like a platelet type of a bleeding or a coagulation type of bleeding, or whether there is an underlying gangrene formation of the skin. Examine the skin carefully to see the site of the petechial lesions, ecchymosis. Where are they in multiple stages of healing? That may give us a suspicion of child abuse. Is there an underlying sinister disorder? So look for hepatosplenomegaly, lymphadenopathy. Is there an underlying malignancy? Joint and extremity examination. Any neurological deficit pointing towards TMA? So a detailed history and a clinical examination can give us a clue to what we are expecting. So no talk in coagulopathy will be complete without discussing the newborn, because coagulation and bleeding is completely different in neonates. Why? Because at a neonatal level, only factors 5, circulating factor 8 and 13 are present in concentrations which reach those of adult values. All the other factors are reduced. Also the fibrinolytic system, so antithrombin 3 and plasminogen is low. The mean protein C antigen level in full-term neonates is also 1/3 of the normal adult mean value. So we have to be careful in making a diagnosis of protein C deficiency. Causes of acquired coagulopathy in neonates: hypoxia, chronic hypoxia because of RDS, preterm, cold injury, maternal preeclampsia, sepsis, PPHN, NEC, thrombosis, indwelling vascular catheters, exchange transfusions. Anyone wants to comment on what is this and why it causes a DIC? Any of the students have want to? So this is a vascular malformation which is seen in newborn babies. It's a Caspak-Merritt syndrome. So there is a consumption coagulopathy. There's trapping of the platelets and the coagulation protein. So these children will be stable and well to look at, but they will have features of DIC. And if they are large, causing significant symptoms, we need to treat them. This is a child with purpura fulminans. And I want to stress that every time in a newborn when we see these gangrenous changes, it's not always essentially a congenital purpura fulminans. Most of the causes will be acquired. So acquired due to severe sepsis can also lead to a severe protein C deficiency and a picture like a purpura fulminans, because in the neonate, it's more of a hypercoagulable state. So I'd like to end with this wise guy's comment on hemostasis, that everything that occurs in between tissue factor activation is really a miracle. Thank you.
Yeah, Dr. Purvi, thanks. It was a very clear presentation, and very, though in a short time you had explained everything, And now I go to Dr. Shweta for the laboratory diagnosis and recent advances in diagnosis as well as management of acquired coagulation. So Dr. Shweta is here only with me, and I just want her to share the screen. Yeah. Hello. Is there Dr. Shweta?
Hi, good evening, everybody. I think this is a very, very important subject, and we face this problem on an everyday basis in our daily clinical life, I would say. So I thank the PA chapter. I thank the PHO chapter to invite us to deliver the knowledge on this acquired coagulation disorders. And after a beautiful lecture of Dr. Bubi. Hello, can you see my slides?
We cannot see the slides, Dr. Shweta. It is just saying that is being shared, but we cannot see the slides.
And we can't see you also, Shweta.
Okay.
I think Sujata has to open up her video.
I think you can stop it once and probably share the screen again one more time, probably.
Share screen one.
Hi, Lightning.
Yeah,
now you can see the slides.
Can you all see the slides?
No,
I can't see the slides. It's again same, it's a dark, a blank screen.
Still not able to see?
No. Maria, we have the presentations.
So one sec, I'll just check.
Yeah.
Is there? Sujata ma'am, had you emailed the presentation?
Oh, yes, I had emailed you. Dr. Shweta's presentation, yeah?
I'm not able to hear you.
Yeah, I had emailed you.
Okay.
Can you see now? No, still not?
No, ma'am. Ma'am, I haven't got it. Can you just email it? I'll share it from my side.
So I think I'll... can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
So I think first two, three slides is just a small introduction only. So I'll just, till the time we are sharing the slides, I'll start.
Ma'am, you can just email it to me. I'll open it from here.
Yeah, we are emailing.
Okay.
So meanwhile, I'll just to save the time. So as Dr. Purvi has said that, the coagulopathy itself is a very, very complex phenomena. And the most important part of the blood is that it wants it to be in a flowing state. So whenever some injury happens to the blood vessels, there is always a tendency of the body system is to prevent the blood to get lost and to help in coagulation. And then there is a system to prevent this coagulation system to become more extensive, and hence there is an anti-coagulation system is also there in the body. So if there is any mismatch or any impaired pro-coagulation or anti-coagulation, it leads to a coagulopathy, and it depends upon what condition the patient is having, and depending upon one or the other phenomena is more predominant. So in acquired coagulopathy, if it remains uncorrected, it can lead to a prolonged and excessive bleeding, and both bleeding and thrombosis we know that exist simultaneously. So as Dr. Purvi, she highlighted that there are certain conditions in which we see predominantly coagulopathy disorder. So any clinical condition can lead to a coagulopathy. But in some conditions like in liver disorders, in sepsis, in trauma, major brain injury, we do see more of a coagulopathy and impaired coagulation system. So depending upon whether there is more of hypofibrinolysis leading to thrombosis like in TTP, TMA, HUS, or now in COVID-19, we can have a, more of a thrombotic features. And if there is more of more of a hypofibrinolysis, then we can have more of a bleeding features. So whenever we need to do an investigation of the DIC, we need to have an early and reliable detection by coagulation tests.
Next slide, Ria. So Shweta, you just if you just tell us, we'll move the slides, sir.
Okay. So yeah. I can. I don't know. I can. Yeah. Okay. So we are on the. Investigation. So early and reliable detection by coagulation test is very, very important. There should be a correct interpretation of the coagulation test in context with the clinical picture. And depending upon the condition of the patient, we need to do some ancillary tests to complete the clinical picture. And then there is a clinical test which should help us in therapeutic interventions. So all the investigations which we do in a coagulopathy should fulfill all these issues. Then, so this is a picture. If fellows can identify the abnormality in this picture, see, this is a very dreaded picture. If I see in my clinical this thing, I will be very worried about the patients. So we can see the schistocytes in this, and there are no, there are hardly any thrombocytes. So there is definitely a patient having a coagulopathy, maybe a TMA or HUS like picture is there. Next slide. So, so we can see schistocytes, there is a polychromasia, there is a thrombocytopenia is there. Next slide. So whenever we are doing a diagnosis of coagulopathy, it starts with the examination of the peripheral smear. A good peripheral smear examination is a very important part of diagnosing the coagulopathy. So when we do peripheral smear examination, we need to see the platelet count, whether it is real or whether it is spurious, because with the EDTA effect also platelet clumping can affect. So if you see a good number of platelets, you don't need to worry about it. Previous slide, please. Previous slide, yeah. So whenever, so if there is a actual thrombocytopenia, then you need to see for the microangiopathy. That is, you need to see whether there are schistocytes present or not. In case there are no schistocytes present, then definitely it could be the platelet, low platelet count could be because of the increased platelet destruction like ITP, or it could be because of the decreased platelet destruction or hypersplenism, many other causes of thrombocytopenia. But if there is a microangiopathy associated with thrombocytopenia, then you have to think of TTP, HUS, endothelial damage, hypertension, help, chemotherapy, vasculitis, and other various conditions. Then coming to the coagulopathy, if the patient is having a coagulopathy associated with these features, then definitely there is a hemostatic dysfunction and it is progressive in nature, then we have to think of DIC. And the most common etiologies are like infection, malignancies, obstetric complications, and and trauma. So this this chart actually help us in how to approach to various clinical pictures and diagnosis and how to interpret these tests. Now, next slide, please. Next. So now coming to the coagulation test, which becomes an important part of any diagnosis of any coagulopathy. As we know that we have two types of coagulation models. One is a waterfall model, another is a cell-based model. In the waterfall model, we have an extrinsic system and intrinsic system, in which there are coagulation factors which control the process mainly. And they say that the cells only provide the phospholipid surface, and it is mostly an in vitro model, and it is designed to monitor the anticoagulation medications. While cell-based, that is a physiological model, is much more physiological, it is much more dynamic, and it recognizes that cellular components, they do play an important role in coagulation system. And the cells, they have different role in hemostasis depending upon the complement of the surface receptors. And it is like whole blood based, and it is like an in vivo test. And it is designed to understand the hemostasis response to various clinical conditions. So next slide. So we come to these. So the quantitative assays are basically based on the waterfall model, and qualitative assays are based on the more dynamic physiological model. So we do PT in quantitative assays. We do prothrombin time, APTT, fibrinogen, platelet count, and D-dimers. These are plasma-based. They do not account the endothelium and other cellular components, and they have limited detection of hypercoagulability. Then in the qualitative assays, we can do the viscoelastic testing. TEG is now available at many places and many hospitals. It is available, though in children or in pediatric cases, it's not that used much. But with the improved understanding and with the more usage, it is coming into play now. And then we can do platelet function testing through echometry testing. So these qualitative assays actually help us in giving a lot of information. Number one is that how to use the blood products also, which I'll come to later. Next slide. So whenever we do quantitative assays, we need to, and when we get these reports, we need to interpret these reports very carefully. So when we see the low platelet count, one is that always check the peripheral smear. And then we know that the low platelet count correlates strongly with the markers of thrombin generation, because thrombin induces platelet aggregation and is mainly responsible for platelet consumption. So whenever you are seeing a patient with bleeding and with a low platelet count, always think if there is any coagulopathy is happening. And the next step is to do the to see the PT and APTT. And if there is a prolonged prothrombin and APTT, then it is mainly attributed to the consumption of coagulation factors, but impaired synthesis due to, but it can happen because of the impaired synthesis due to abnormal liver function, vitamin K deficiency, or loss of coagulation proteins due to massive bleeding may also play a role. Similarly, shortened PT and APTT we see. My slides. I can't see.
Ria, we have lost the slide screen.
One second. Now, can you see?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, I can see.
Go on the slideshow. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Next slide. Ria, next slide.
Just one second. It's paused. No. Now is it visible?
Yes. But I think slideshow you have to start.
Yeah, just
Put it on slideshow mode.
Yes.
Sorry for all the glitches.
No problem. Yeah.
So whenever we have a normal prothrombin and APTT time, it does not exclude the activation of the hemostatic system, and repeat monitoring is required, especially when there is a high index of suspicion in depending upon the clinical picture. And it should also be emphasized that the prothrombin time, not the INR, that should be monitored, because we know INR is being validated only for the oral anticoagulant monitoring. Then the thrombin time, mostly we do in the conditions like hypofibrinogenemia or afibrinogenemia. But these can be performed in ill patients with suspected DIC. Though it does not have a place in the agreed scoring system of the DIC, but it may be used along with the reptilase time to exclude the heparin contamination of samples in patients with prolonged APTT. So it can help us in seeing whether this prolonged PT and APTT is because of the heparin contamination or is it actually a problem. Next slide.
Can you see, ma'am? I can't put it on full screen for some reason.
Okay, I can see it.
Now, now can you see it?
Yes, I can see. Okay.
Ma'am, you can control the slide. I have given you remote access. You can change it yourself.
Okay, so this add slide.
Okay. Yeah, you know, you can just press next, you know, forward or backward.
Okay. So fibrinogen levels are widely advocated, but they are not useful because they are acute phase reactant and they're sensitive in only 428%. Then assays of FTPs, fibrin degradation product, do not discriminate between degradation products of cross-linked fibrin and fibrinogen degradation, which limits their specificity. Similarly, D-dimer, FDP and D-dimer assays can be influenced by liver and kidney impairment. So this should be carefully interpreted in these patients. Not standalone tests are there. And D-dimer assay results need to be interpreted based on the clinician experience and consideration of the clinical circumstances. So sometimes in even a normal patient, we see a high D-dimer level. Like recently, we have one patient of cancer, leukemia, and that patient had a D-dimer level of almost 14,000. So before doing anything, I mean, we just started the patient on a steroid therapy and his D-dimer came nicely down. So I think a proper interpretation in clinical scenario is very, very important. Next slide. So other markers of DIC, we have other anticoagulants like antithrombin and protein C, which are often reduced in DIC, but these have been shown to have not much prognostic significance. However, in very rare cases of purpura fulminans, which develops secondary to profound acquired deficiency of protein S. So maybe in these cases, we need to do protein C and protein S levels as well. So this is a little busy slide and maybe not so clearly visible, but it actually tells us about the phases and the laboratory data of the coagulation activation leading to DIC. So DIC is actually a very dynamic phenomena, as we can have a actually compensated mechanism, we can have a non-overt DIC, and we can have an overt DIC. And if we have a high clinical scenario in which this coagulopathy can happen, we can do multiple tests to actually follow up the patients and to understand whether they are going from compensated to decompensation, from non-overt DIC to overt DIC. And many studies have shown that if you do intervention early, especially at the stage of non-overt DIC, which is an early decompensation of hemostatic system, then the mortality can be decreased. But many of the times, this subclinical state is actually missed, and many studies have reported that the mortality is almost in non-over DIC, and over DIC is similar. So important follow-up of the coagulation test and doing it in a proper phase manner is very, very important to detect this early decompensation of hemostatic system. So DIC diagnosis and scoring systems, we can realize that there is no single lab test or set of tests that is available which is sensitive or specific enough to allow a definitive diagnosis of DIC. So there is a Japanese body that has made a scoring system for the DIC, and it's actually quite helpful, more though in adults. And they have said if there is a risk, first of all, you have to do the risk assessment. Does the patient have an underlying disorder which is known to be associated with over DIC? If yes, then you can proceed. In that, you have to check the platelet counts and do the scoring accordingly, depending upon the platelet count, elevated fibrin marker like D-dimers or FTPs, then prolonged PT and fibrinogen level. And if the score is more than 5, then it is compatible with over DIC. Then you repeat the score daily to see how the patient is doing, depending upon the intervention which is done. And if it's less than 5, then suggest for the non-over DIC, and then you can repeat every 1 or 2 days and you can see how the patient is behaving. So there are other scoring systems also which shows the non-scoring for the non-over DIC also, and they are more dynamic in a way that they consider how the platelet count is falling, whether it is falling by 20% or 30% over the 2 days, or how the D-dimer is increasing, and accordingly they make a the clinical judgment regarding the intervention. So now coming to the investigation tech tracing, which is actually becoming a good clinical part of the investigations. And in the tech, actually, there are two parts. One is that coagulation and fibrinolysis. The first part is for the coagulation system, and second part is to check the fibrinolysis. So we have there is a reaction time. The reaction time is mainly nothing. It helps in finding out how early the clot is formed. So it makes up coagulation proteins. Then we have a K time, which actually depends upon the how firm is the clot. So clot firmness depends upon the fibrin levels. So it helps tells us about the fibrinogen. Then we have a maximum amplitude of the clot formation. And we know that the clot formation platelets play an important role, and then hence it tells us about the platelet function. And then it is followed by the clot lysis in next 30 minutes. If there is a increase in the clot lysis, then we know that there is a hypofibrinolysis. And if there is a decrease in the clot lysis, then there is a hypofibrinolysis there. So how we can do intervention? If there is a prolonged R time, then we can give FFP and reversal of heparin. If there is a short R time, that is, there is an increased thrombin formation is there, it means that there is a hypercoagulable state is there. And then if it is, there is a prolonged K time, because it tells us about the clot firmness. So there is a hypo or dysfibrinogenemia could be there, and precipitates can be given. Then if there is a amplitude of the clot formation is low, then it could be because of the platelet dysfunction and platelets will be required. And if there is a more of 7.5% of clot lysis in 30 minutes, then there is a hyperfibrinolysis, and maybe you can intervene with antifibrinolytic agents like tranexamic acid. So goal-directed therapy in trauma-induced coagulopathy has shown a superior survival. The patients who've been followed by TEG and done intervention with the required blood products, they had a better survival when they were followed with just conventional coagulation tests. So we have a treatment in this. No empirical blood transfusion is should be done, and it should be only goal-directed blood transfusions. So we have multiple replacement therapies like anticoagulants, restoration of the anticoagulant pathways, and other agents are there, which we'll be doing discussing in our case discussions also. So replacement therapy, we are always worried about that the administration of the blood components may add fuel to the fire, but this has never been proven in clinical and experimental studies. So wherever it is required, it should be done, but it should not be done without any goal. So we have anticoagulants, we have replacement platelet transfusions. So depending upon the clinical scenario, we can do the therapy accordingly. In cases of platelet transfusions, we should be giving platelets only cases of active bleeding or where invasive procedure is required. Threshold will depend upon the clinical scenario, and there is no point in giving platelets just to correct the low platelet count. Similarly, the patients for giving FFT, the patients who are requiring massive transfusion to correct the warfarin coagulopathy in the setting of ICH and invasive procedure or where there is an increased risk of bleeding is there. Prophylactic transfusions in non-bleeding patients is a contraindication for FFP transfusion. Then we have other products like prothrombin concentrate complex, which lacks important factor like factor 5. So it should be used with proper, if the patient really requires it, then only it should be used. And then PCC and DIC should be used with caution as it contains activated factors. Then there is a fibrinogen deficiency can be corrected by using a fibrinogen and cryoprecipitate. Successful use of recombinant 7A in DIC life-threatening bleed has been reported. So if you, just a small example, if the patient in ER came with fever and respiratory distress, had hypertension and tachycardia, had a low platelet count and deranged coagulation profile, they needed to put the CVL line. So what will you do? You will give platelets to the patient, FFP or both, or none to the patient. So this patient had a tech study. He had normal R time. Normal K time means the clot formation and clot firmness was good. He had normal MA time, means the platelets were function was also good, but had shortened clot lysis. So he was actually in the hyperfibrinolytic state, and if giving transfusion, actually may would have worsened the condition. This is how we can interpret the studies. So we have now various neuroagents also. To help us in DIC other than the plasma products like antithrombin 3, activated protein C, and TFPI. I'll just go through the activated protein C because this is more easily available and it is being used in our scenarios. So protein C actually thrombin on the endothelial cells, there is a thrombomodulin, and when thrombin comes in contact with thrombomodulin, it activates the protein C, which actually cleaves the factor 5 and factor 8 and prevents the further coagulation. So this is how activated protein C helps us. So the various studies shows that protein C can help, and some of the studies are having actually contradictory statements. So the PROMISE trial showed that it did has a 28-day improvement in mortality, but other studies, they did not show such good results. So now the recommendation is that activated protein C should be used in the patient who have multi-organ failure rather than only one organ failure, and who are having the Apache score more than 25 rather than less seriousness. So activated protein C should be used only in patients where it is actually needed. Otherwise, it has no meaning in improving the mortality of the patient. I can't move the slide. So take-home messages is acquired coagulopathy, common in wide variety of conditions. It is associated with poor outcomes. And the management of acquired coagulopathy in this early and reliable assessment by quantitative and qualitative assays should be done. And there should be treatment of underlying conditions, and only goal-directed blood transfusion products should be done. Thank you. Now over to Dr. Sunjata to discuss the cases.
Thank you, Dr. Shweta. It has been very laborious discussion about the patho laboratory diagnosis and the latest management. Now we will quickly go to the cases, and I ask Dr. Lekha to share the screen from her side about case discussion. Am I hearing Dr. Lekha? Yeah. Yeah, Lekha, could you share the screen or?
I have shared the screen.
Yes, ma'am, we can see.
Can we? Okay.
Yeah, come.
Good evening, everyone. The first case was a 4-year-old female child. She presented with complaints of fever since 2 days and 1 episode of generalized tonic-clonic seizure with history of 2 episodes of vomiting 1 day prior. There was also history of altered sensorium since afternoon. No history of head injury or fall, no history of cox or cox contact, no history of rash or any ear discharge. There was no history suggestive of any other foci of infection. Our case two is an 8-year-old male school student who presented to the EPR with complaints of generalized malaise and high-grade fever, and associated with published discoloration on the skin. There was also pain in the legs. There was a history of complaints of vomiting and diarrhea on the preceding day. The patient developed facial discoloration rapidly during the time from when he left the house and till the time he reached the EPR. There was significant history, past history trauma in the form of road traffic accident 5 days back, in which he suffered a chest injury. Further on examination, our first patient was semi-conscious with GCS of 7/15 with tachycardia. BP was more little on the lower side. There was mild pallor present, but there was no jaundice or no bleeding from any other side. Anthropometry-wise, the child was normal for age. Our second patient was febrile, conscious, had tachycardia, tachypnea, also had steady pulse, both extremities and hypertension. Local examination revealed a published discoloration on this moment. Further on systemic examination, patient 1 had unequal pupils, hypotonia, brisk reflexes, and bilateral extensor plantars. The other systems were within normal limits. Our case 2 had a respiratory only basal consistent, otherwise there was tachycardia present with heart rate. CNS wise, the child was anxious, having anxious look, and was responding to commands.
So first case was more like an infective encephalitis with or might be an intracranial bleed or an SOL, whereas in the second case was exactly like a septic shock or a Dane shock. And then later on, we proceeded with the investigations. And Dr. Lekha, just explain the investigations, what we did.
For patient 1, we had a significant drop in hemoglobin and platelet on day 3 of admission. Hemoglobin had dropped from 11.2 to 69.9, and platelet had dropped from 248,000 to 84,000. SGOT and SGPT were raised 3 times on day 3, and the CREAT were within normal limits. However, on case 2, we had on day 1 itself, there was thrombocytopenia present. There was also some mild elevation of SGOT, SGPT, which significantly deranged and CREAT 38 and 3.3 were the values. Further investigation spends for case 1, significantly raised to 16.67. LDH and ferritin were also raised, and interleukin 6 was also slightly on the higher side. COVID-19 test was done for this patient, and on day 2, it turned out to be positive. Radiologically, we did an MRI for this child. Had a mild cerebral bleed with ischemic changes in the left parieto-occipital area. MR angio was suggestive of attenuation of cortical branches of left posterior cerebral artery, which was suggestive of thrombosis. For case 2, special investigations which we did were suggestive of a blood culture positive for Staph aureus, which was sensitive to methicillin and cephalosporin and fluoropyrimidines. The peripheral blood smear was suggestive of normocytic normochromic picture with thrombocytopenia, along with a polypredominant picture. Deng NS1 and Deng IgM we had done, which was negative. Further on the coagulation profile for this patient, we had for patient 1, thrombocytopenia. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so to quickly go again with the investigations of case 1 versus case 2, in case platelets were not less than 50,000. PT, APTT was not deranged. TT was also normal. D-dimer was high, like 16.67 micrograms per ml. And fibrin was low normal, but still normal. So as per IHT score, his DIG score was 5. Versus the second case, whose platelets were less than 50,000, PT was deranged. D-dimer was high, more than normal, but not too high. And the fibrin were drastically low. So as per the score for DIC was 7 in the case 2. So next slide. So for Dr. Shehnaz, could you just elaborate on what could be the fallacies in the collection and transport of the sample, since most of our residents face this problem and might be wrong in interpreting the reports, and what could be the false negative and false positive for these results? Dr. Shehnaz?
Yeah, yes. Can you just go through my presentation? Next slide.
So
one of the most challenging areas of laboratory is coagulation testing, as you all know. because of the high number of, because coagulation tests are so influenced by the pre-analytical variables. You know, analytical variables are very easy to address nowadays because we run a lot of quality control, we do comparisons, etc. But it's the pre-analytical variables that really affect coagulation testing. And at, in a study done in 2002, it was estimated that about 32 to 68% of all the lab errors are pre-analytical. And therefore, all these errors will lead to falsely prolonged screening tests, and they will be very costly. And if you get a wrong result, you know, result of a screening test, you will then advise the patient to do some more costly and expensive and time-consuming tests. And if, for instance, the patient has a bleeding disorder, but you have not identified or diagnosed that, it can lead to surgical complications or inappropriate drug therapy in cases where you have diagnosed something wrong. So very, very importantly, we all have to, focus on these. So these are the ones that basically cause all, most of the errors. So next slide, please. So there is, again, an article which was written much earlier. It's in 2007, and you can see that about 61.9% of the errors of in any coagulation test are pre-analytical, and there are stupid things like, you know, an empty tube collection, a tube filling error, which is the commonest cause of these errors, as I will tell you. And the other causes are samples not stored or refrigerated properly. Then sometimes the tube goes missing. You have a requisition form, but you don't have a corresponding tube. The commonest errors in inpatient are the patient identification errors. And even in outpatient, where sometimes people who are collecting are in a big hurry, they put the wrong label on the wrong tube. So sometimes the request which comes from the physician is not a correct request. If there's a kind of a platelet disorder, they order coagulation tests. So all these are very commonly encountered errors in the lab. Sometimes the physician's order is missed, or the order is misinterpreted. The physician wants you to do some tests, you're doing something else. So these are all very common, and they really constitute to, they make up a large percentage of the errors that we face in coagulation tests. However, now, when we now have come to know this, we have to keep on improving upon these. And when we did a little survey in our lab, out of 1,800 samples, we found only 18 were rejected. That is only 1%, which we found 10 were clotted samples. Then in 5 samples, the requisition forms and samples were not matching. As I told you, wrong labeling. Insufficient sample, that is the amount of sample one needs to collect for coagulation testing, was not there, and that will give you wrong results, and hemolyzed samples. So these were the common ones. So therefore, every lab should maintain a rejection log so that you can know your own rate of rejection. Next. So I'll quickly run through these because I know we are short of time. So sample collection is a huge problem. Many people do not instruct the patient whether the patient needs to be fasting or not, because many of the automated coagulation analyzers now are optical based, which require that the patient should be fasting. Otherwise, if it's a turbid sample, it will interfere with the reading. So you need to tell the patient that, or if you're doing some assays like factor 8, etc., increase with stress and activity. So or if like von Willebrand is an acute phase reactant, and if you are doing that in a patient who has some inflammation, then you are obviously not going to get correct results. So you need to know all this, and history taking is very important. And patient identification and sample labeling, as I told you, you have to constantly keep a watch on that, on the phlebotomist or the nurse, whoever is collecting. Then the phlebotomy technique has to be good. They have to be trained. It has to be clean puncture. The needle cannot be very narrow. It has to be at least a 21 gauge needle. Cannot be a very narrow one. Of course, in children, you will use a butterfly. But still, a butterfly can do a clean puncture and it comes out very nicely. The important thing is the ratio of the sample volume to the blood coagulant, which should be 9:1. The only anticoagulant used is 3.2% sodium citrate, and many times in other situations where people are not well trained, you can get blood collected in some other anticoagulant which certainly you cannot proceed with. Then once a sample reaches the lab, centrifugation is a very, very important step, because we need to remove all the platelets which are in the sample, because they will interfere with phospholipid dependent tests like APTT, lupus anticoagulant, etc. So you have to spin the sample at you have to spin the sample at 2500 G for 15 minutes so that the platelet count comes below 10,000 in every sample. So you can just do some few samples and see that your centrifugation is correct or not. Then you have to store the sample correctly. Now it is known that PT is stable at our room temperature, meaning ambient temperature or air conditioned temperature for 24 hours. You can keep the sample outside. Whereas APTT should be done within 4 hours of collection. And if you're anticipating that you're going to do the test little later, then it is very wise to separate out the plasma from the RBC so that you can get better results. Then you have the D-dimer, which is stable at room temperature for 8 hours in saturated plasma, but separate plasma as soon as possible. That would give you better results. Transport sample to the lab as quickly as possible, and you will read in many articles that room temperature but those are in Western countries where their ambient temperature is very good, like it should be between 18 and 24 degrees, and in our country where the temperature is so high, it is wise if you are going to send the sample somewhere to refrigerate it, not freeze. Do not freeze samples, but yeah, refrigeration. And there are some other patient factors which are physiological. Next slide, please. So you have some physiological conditions where you can get different coagulation test values, such as pregnancy factor 8 and von Willebrand factor, and the fibrinogen levels rise, whereas the protein S level falls. And when following stress and exercise, you can get a high factor 8 level. Then we just spoke about EDTA clumping. So we have to always, whenever there is a low platelet count, always make it a practice to first see the slide under the microscope before giving off the count, just based on the analyzer. So there should be a protocol like that in the laboratory. And importantly for pediatricians, there are age-dependent variables such as vitamin K-dependent coagulation factors we know are reduced at birth, and they slowly reach adult values, say in 6 months time. So very small children can have prolonged coagulation times, which are normal for their age. Children have physiologically lower levels of both the anticoagulants and the procoagulants in a balanced manner, so that they don't either bleed or clot. So because of that, you can get a raised PT and raised APTT. And therefore, age-related reference ranges need to be determined for children for every reagent and analyzer combination. With whatever you are using in your lab, you should make an age reference range for the age groups in your lab. That is very necessary. Otherwise, you will be interpreting these tests wrongly. And also, it has been reported that there can be differences due to racial composition as well. Then certain other pathological causes are that we know that there are some acute, like in acute thrombosis or acute events, all the factors will be consumed and you'll get low levels of all the factors. So therefore, if you get low protein C and protein S, you must strongly suspect that it cannot be that the patient has, you know, both protein C and protein S deficiency. So you have to go again when the patient is not having an acute episode, or if the patient has been giving some anticoagulants, then you cannot test these. Cryoglobulins interfere with platelet counts. High bilirubin and lipid levels also interfere, especially with these optical density measurements. So there are some assays that cannot be performed when the patient is on anticoagulation therapy. Next. So the functional assays, basically protein C or protein S, or any functional assay cannot be run when the patient is on warfarin. And however, if there are antigenic assays for those tests, you can do it, or molecular assays can be done. For example, you cannot do APCR or APC resistance analysis when the patient is on anticoagulant, but you can do the molecular test, which is the factor V Leiden mutation. And DRVVT and the phospholipid dependence for confirming lupus anticoagulation should not be done when the patient is on anticoagulant. But you can do the anticardiolipin antibody and the anti-beta 2 glycoprotein test. And these are the practical issues that are faced by us, because APTT is high in children, so we do not know whether it is actually pathological or within the normal range. Then you have a high hematocrit commonly seen in children, which can again give you high PTPTT. I'll just quickly show you why. Then platelet function tests, we need large volumes. It's difficult for us to collect those volumes of the patient and the control. And sometimes keeping reagents out for too long, that also is a pre-analytical thing that you should follow the protocol, etc. And then we have many times borderline cases, which is a dilemma for us. And we have lupus anticoagulant, which we need to do two tests to confirm it. But if one comes positive and one negative, we are in a dilemma. So we have to ask for repeat. Then we do the anti-factor Xa assay, but we need to know which anticoagulant you're giving because the reagents are different for different sets of anticoagulants. So low molecular weight heparins and others. Therefore, we have to know that. And this is just quickly to show you all that this is if this is a normal sample where a normal amount of plasma is separated from your sample and the anticoagulant only acts in this amount of plasma. The citrate anticoagulant does not mix with the RBCs. Whereas in a patient who has a high hematocrit, a very small volume of plasma gets separated and the anticoagulant which mixes with this obviously then will cause more prolonged times. So therefore, once when you do a, you have to do a correction. There's a correction in which instead of putting the normal amount of anticoagulant, if you're depending upon the hematocrit, you can titrate your anticoagulant volume and do your test accordingly if you want to get the correct result for that. And so we found that, all right, we found that the PT and APTT were prolonged in a patient who had a high hematocrit, but when we corrected, we found that they came down. Yeah, so next. Yeah, so basically these factors are so very important that, you know, we don't want to be like this shopkeeper who's selling this rope to a mountain climber and telling, you know, being careless enough to tell him that I've sold you 45 meters and you're just finding fault with this little bit. So that is not how we should be looking at our coagulation tests. Next. And we basically need to overcome the challenge by just being very, very vigilant. Yeah, so some of the situations in which you can get false positive D-dimers are when there are a presence of high titers of cross-reacting rheumatoid factors or an increase in certain hormones such as the tumor markers such as CA125, or if the specimen is overfilled, if the specimen is not correctly filled, not the 9:1 ratio is not maintained, then you can have a false negative D-dimer if the specimen is underfilled. Then heparin or oral anticoagulant therapy, you know, causes reduction in fibrin formation. Therefore, you can get a reduced D-dimer erroneously if the patient is on heparin or oral anticoagulant. So you cannot perform the D-dimer on them.
Yeah, Lekha, next slide.
Ma'am, should I stop your screen sharing?
Yeah. Okay. Where is it? Yeah.
You can continue your presentation if you want, or I can take the question.
We can,
however you want. Next.
Yeah, because now we will have a bit more of clinical things to discuss. Yeah. Next. Next. One more next. Again. So we, So, Madam, Dr. Rashmi, Madam, could you just elaborate with how sensitive this DIC score is there in pediatric patients? Means, should we really implement this DIC scoring or not in pediatric patients, basically? And in COVID-19, how thrombosis is and bleeding, how we explain for this patient, case one?
With respect to the DIC score, it has basically mainly been studied in adults, and the ISTH score shown a 91% sensitivity and 97% specificity in adult DIC. But we don't have very clear data in pediatric DIC. There is some amount of data in DIC in children with leukemias, and actually the sensitivity and specificity are much lower. So in fact, they have taken, instead of a cutoff of 5, they have looked at a cutoff of 6. But yet the sensitivity specificity is nowhere near 90%. However, it is a practically useful score to go by, but you cannot, you have to treat the patient as a whole with respect to the lab parameters and the clinical bleeding or thrombosis, whatever is happening. So, but since we don't have any other score, we do use this. There are other variations. There's a Texas Children's score and there's a Japanese score also, which kind of matches the ISTH score. But we don't have anything which comes close to 90% as far as the score goes. And with respect to COVID-19 and thrombosis and bleeding, so if you look at your...
So basically, what I want to say is basically these two cases, I've taken two cases with a wide spectrum. One having thrombosis as a major presentation with mild bleeding, and second as a frank DIC who is bleeding profusely and come into shock. So with such a wide spectrum of presentation, with the same like sepsis, how do we go ahead with the treatment?
So basically, one thing we have to remember that DIC is very every patient is unique, and every patient's clinical and lab profile is a unique footprint, and it depends on various factors. It depends on your trigger, depends on how or the age of the patient. You have whether you have coagulation. Anticoag system is immature, whether you have other premorbid or comorbid states, and even the pathways are different. You have the endothelial pathway, you have the mononuclear cells inflammatory process, and you have a balance of hypercoagulation and hyperfibrinolysis, which you've already been discussed. So treating DIC actually is like walking on a tightrope. So, there is concomitant thrombosis and bleeding, and this, makes it challenging. But what we have to remember is that we have to treat the patient and not the laboratory test. So, given in spite of the wide spectrum and all these variations, the first thing that is important is you try and figure out the underlying cause or the trigger factor. And if that is treatable, that is most important. So, vigorous treatment of the underlying or causative factor is number one and very important if it is treatable. For example, in your in the two cases that you showed, now staph sepsis is much more clearly treatable than COVID-19. COVID-19, we have things, but we are not very sure. Then the further decisions about will depend upon whether there's thrombosis or bleeding and replacement therapy.
What many residents face is like whether they should start with conventional heparin or directly go on to LMWH.
Yeah.
So that is what they face.
Again, I want to just give the overall picture that we have to remember that in DIC in children, bleeding manifestations are 10 times more common than thrombotic manifestations. If you are talking about thrombosis, then you have to use anticoagulants only if there is life-threatening thrombosis or there is symptomatic thrombosis, like say CNS thrombosis or even very extensive skin thrombosis also warrants therapy. But you have to remember that you patient should have no bleeding if you're going to anticoagulate. And also patients with severe liver dysfunction should, be avoided. You should avoid anticoagulating in such a patient. So when you are anticoagulating, ideal is unfractionated heparin, but practically what is practically possible is low molecular weight heparin. And apart from that, replacement therapy, I want to just say a little bit because as I said, bleeding is a more common manifestation. Again, here it is the aim when you're treating is not to stop the bleeding, but not correct the lab abnormalities. So, if you have a patient who is not bleeding, you should not be, giving replacement therapy. But if a patient is bleeding, you have to aim to stop the bleeding and not correct the abnormalities. So you maintain platelets above 50,000. You maintain serum fibrinogen above 100 milligrams per DL. And what is typically used is cryoprecipitate, which is rich in factor 8 and fibrinogen, or FFP. So... is that okay?
Ma'am?
Is that okay?
Yes, I guess it.
I think Dr. Sujata has got disconnected. Ma'am, since Dr. Sujata has got disconnected, there are some questions in the chat box. Would the experts like to address those?
Sure. Go ahead.
Just give me a minute. So there's one question by Dr. Devashish, which is, how sensitive is TEG to detect hypercoagulable states? Can it be used as a screening test?
I think Shweta also must have been disconnected along with Sujata.
Yes, ma'am. I think Rashmi is here.
So what was the question?
How sensitive is TEG to detect hypercoagulable states?
Hypo.
Yes, hyper.
Hyper. TEG is basically a very good system to a very good bedside system, basically, to tell you whether the clot has been formed, how firm is the clot, and or whether the defect in your sample is due to hyperfibrinolysis. And it goes one step further. The newer TEGs and they're actually telling you about even, you know, suggesting the treatment that you can give. They can say this so and so is the MA is the problem, you can give platelets, or the clot is not firm enough, or you know the clot is taking long to things. So yeah, if it does give you some idea about hyperfibrinolysis and hypercoagulable states as well. So you can interpret.
Ma'am, there's from the TEG. Question about how to send samples for TEG.
Sample for TEG, I think. TG and Rotem, I think, are whole blood samples. In maybe whole blood meaning in citrate, I guess you have to send them. You have to send them inside, because citrate is the anticoagulant for most coagulation assays, 3.2% sodium citrate. So you need to send them. But where would you send? I don't think many laboratories have the TG facility, and TG is of great value to people who are, you know, going to use the information immediately. And also, I'll tell you that there is no comparison between doing a TEG and doing PT-PTT. So it's very difficult to be able to, because we are more used to treating based on the routine coagulation tests, the screening coagulation tests that we are doing, like the PTA, PTT, fibrinogen levels, etc. So If you don't know how to interpret your TEG, it's difficult to treat from that point of view. Because these two tests are so different. One is a global, assays, and one are these conventional assays. So hardly any validation studies and hardly any comparison studies have been done also. It was very difficult. You know, it's like comparing apples to oranges. So you don't, it's difficult.
So Dr. Neeta has some comments on that.
Sure, go ahead.
Ma'am, you can unmute yourself, ma'am, Dr. Neeta.
My signal is quite poor. So just to carry on with the TEG discussion, TEG is helpful in, can you hear me, Paramita?
Yes, ma'am.
So TEG is helpful in some liver transplant cases and some patients who have prolonged surgery. So this equipment is actually placed inside the ICUs only. And you can take the sample and run it there and then and there itself. And it helps, it broadly gives you an idea as to what is deficient, but it's routinely not used in children with bleeding at all.
Okay.
Any other questions from anyone? Dr. Sujata has just come back. Ma'am, there is another question about what are the long-term effects of DIC on coagulation status of patients?
So, with respect to DIC, I think it's either you come out of it or you don't, you know, more or less. So by and large, acute DIC, such as the cases that were presented. So if you manage to treat the DIC and you recover from it, by and large, there is no significant renal or hepatic dysfunction. Unless, there's a lot of CNS involvement in terms of thrombosis, then that can, may leave some sequelae. But most of the acute DICs that children that we manage, if they come out of it, they are okay. But if you talk about, HUS, TTP, they... depending again on where the thrombosis is, you can have sequelae. Bleeding by and large will not cause sequelae.
Sujata ma'am, are you here now? Ma'am, we can hear you.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
I'll be there from the mobile only. Lekha can share the screen, right? Okay. Next slide, Lekha. Hello, next. Yeah. So this is what you can say, how do you approach after doing a clinical examination and doing a DIC score, which may not be very important for pediatric patients, but if at all he's saying active bleeding, we go for platelet. This, I think madam has already explained when you are supposed to give platelets, which factors you are supposed to give. You keep the fibrinogen level above 1.5 if it is in frank DIC, and vitamin K supplementation as whatever the liver can produce the coagulation factors, and antifibrinolytics can be also added only in cases of hyperfibrinolysis. If there is no major bleeding, you can prophylactic give LMWH. As we have said, there is a consumptive coagulopathy occurring within his body for DIC. And then if it is an overt thromboembolic phenomena, then you can give either unfractionated, but I said low molecular weight heparin is more preferred as compared to unfractionated. So next slide. These are some of the recommendations which are given in DIC. When there is a frank bleeding, you are supposed to give blood products. Heparin is not indicated in frank bleeding. Antifactor-10s are also not indicated. Synthetic protease inhibitors are indicated in bleeding types and massive bleeding types, while natural ones are indicated in organ failure. And antifibrinolytics are indicated in severe bleeding. So this is just a generalized approach as to which drugs should be selected. And these are different mechanisms where the drugs can act. Just one slide which could just tell us where all things of antithrombosis is required. So we can go on to next presentation. Dr. Nina, you can share a slide. Nina. Next case we'll be having with Dr. Nina Fade, who's a fellow with PHO. Yeah. Yeah, Nina, present the case.
Yes, ma'am.
A little quick and fast. Yeah, we're short of time. Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. So my case, 12-year-old male born of non-consanguineous marriage residing at Goregaon, presented to the emergency ward with the complaints of fatigue since 1 week, nosebleed since 3 days. There was no family history of bleeding or thrombosis, no medication, denies recreational drugs, fever with rash. There was no medical history, birth history wise, born at term, developmental milestone achieved for age, anthropometry normal for age. On general examination, heart rate was 120 and respiratory rate is 32 per minute. So there is tachypnea and tachycardia. On local examination, we found there were blood clots in both nostrils and petechial hemorrhage in mouth and lower extremities. On upper abdomen examination, there was organomegaly with liver 2 cm and spleen 3 cm, and other systems were normal. So going towards the lab results, WBC counts were 7,700 with HbA of 6.7 and platelet count was 9,000. So there was a bicytopenia. And on peripheral smear, there was metamyelocyte, promyelocyte, myelocyte, myeloblasts, all elevated above normal levels. All other lymphocyte, monocyte, eosinophil, basophil were in normal range. Our PT and APTT were in raised, like PT was 47 seconds and APTT was 75 seconds. Fibrinogen level were low, less than 76 milligram per deciliter, and D-dimer was high, that is 9.0 microgram per ml. So we did bone marrow, which showed 72% of myelocytes with the OR rods. Immunophenotyping showed expression of CD9, CD13, and CD33 with a CD34 negative. FISH revealed translocation 15-17. The PML-RARA fusion was confirmed by RT-PCR. So this was a case of APML, AML-M3 according to FACT classification. This was a microscopy picture with the giant platelets and promyelocytes with the OR rods. These are some questions for Shweta ma'am. Ma'am, what Shweta? Will be the...
Yeah, so in this case, Dr. Shweta, could you just tell me, you had already think I explained the mechanism of DIC in APML. We just want to know what would be the drug suggested for this condition and why. And how do you monitor DIC in case of APML? Does it differ from any other monitoring?
Mm.
Yeah.
DIC
actually
is DIC in APML is actually quite similar to other DICs, but it has some differences. That the DIC over here happens because of the leukemic blasts, which are having tissue factors and cancer procoagulants, and which actually initiate the whole coagulopathy. And there is also an increase in the fibrinolytic activity, and there is a non-specific protease activity also. So there is a system which is, there is an activation of the clotting system, and there is a hyperfibrinolysis at the same time. So when we are doing the monitoring of DIC of APML, we need to do the platelet counts, we need to do the coagulation profile, we need to do the D-dimers and low fibrinogen levels. So first, we see all these reports and accordingly we manage the patients. Mostly the management of the DIC goes with the platelet transfusions. Mostly the patient is bleeding. So any bleeding will warrant the admission of or the transfusion of the platelets. And if the patient is non-bleeding, then our motive is always to keep the platelet count above 50,000. Then second is the patient for the coagulopathy, we monitor these patients mainly with the fibrinogen levels, and we try to maintain the fibrinogen levels more than 150 in these patients. So regarding the monitoring, for these patients, we do daily platelet count and fibrinogen level for these patients to understand how the coagulopathy is functioning. And then second is we start these patients on ETRA or ATO. So ETRA and ATO both are having a different mechanisms of controlling the coagulopathy in these patients. ETRA is mainly work with differentiation, and it helps in decreasing the procoagulant expressed in the leukemic blast, while ATP works through the mechanism of apoptosis and it decreases the tissue factor as well as procoagulant activity. So which agent is much better, whether it is ETRA or ATO in controlling the coagulopathy? So many studies have shown that if you're doing a combination of ETRA and ATO, the coagulopathy is controlled in much better manner. There is no advantage of one over the other. Both are having similarly effective, but if you use them in combination, definitely the coagulopathy gets improved in better and much earlier. And ETRA alone almost takes 1 to 2 weeks, but when you're using a combination, it takes less than 2 weeks time to get corrected.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Shweta. We now move on to next case. Dr. Lekha, back to the presentation. Yeah. Do we have time?
Ma'am, so, in short, 5:30.
This is a very, Lekha, can you be very brisk, crisp and short in this case?
Yes, ma'am. A 7-year-old male child who presented with fever since 15 days with pallor and petechia since 5 to 6 days. She also had one episode of convulsion on the day of admission. Past history, important history in terms of the child having received platelet transfusions 4 to 5 times in lieu of negative history, no history of diarrhea or dysentery, no history suggestive of any renal involvement, no history of any joint pains, neurological complaints or any neuropsychiatric symptoms. Examination-wise, the child had severe pallor and severe rictus present. There were petechiae and purpurae on the extremities and trunk. Anthropometry-wise, the child was less than height and weight, but less than 5 centimeters. CNS-wise, the child was conscious and oriented after the postictal phase. There were no
focus. Systemic-wise, he's okay. Yeah. So, with this, what would be our clinical diagnosis? Then you enumerate the diagnosis. It could be acute presentation of chronic illness. It could be chronic ITP. It could be Evans syndrome, or it could be a collagen vascular disease. Or being low in HB as well as in platelets, we also thought of constitutional failure, bone marrow failures. But later again, he was investigated. Next slide. I'll only talk now. Lekha, next slide. So his investigation showed platelet counts were HB was low when he came to us. The counts were slightly on the lower side, but platelets initially were 42,000, which were decreased to 40,000. Retic was slightly high. Next slide. And his peripheral smear showed cystocytes, polychromasia, basophilic ticklin with broken cells and few normoblasts. His LDH was high. His bilirubin was high with more of indirect, but BUN creatinine was normal. He had a D-dimer, which was 1.2 micrograms per liter. Fibrinogen were normal. PT-APTTs were normal. So additional investigations which required for diagnosis were next. He had a mild proteinuria, occult blood present, but his direct and indirect womb test was negative. His ANA, DSDNA was normal, only small rise in anti-Smith antibodies. Otherwise, his ELISA status was also negative. Next. So with this in mind, we thought of some TMA. So more of a CNS presentation with thrombocytopenia and microcytic cystocytes and polychromasia on the smear. We thought of TTP over HUS, and therefore we tried to do ADAMCS activity, but as it is, it's not done or anywhere in Mumbai, neither in NIH or Hinduja. So finally, our diagnosis was either it is an HUS or TTP. So basically, how to proceed, Dr. Rashmi, could you just elaborate as to how to think over whether it is a TTP or an HUS? It's only because most of the laboratories won't explain exactly what the diagnosis could be. We won't be able to reach to a diagnosis. So it's more of a clinical thing. So how to reach to a thought process whether it could be a TTP or an HUS?
Right. You have a 7-year-old child who has received some platelet transfusions off and on for the past 3 years, mm-hmm. and now has this, some fever and pallor and convulsions. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And all your other tests, things which could have been like HIV and all are negative. So you have anemia now with reticulocytosis with a peripheral smear suggestive of schistocytes and DIC like picture. You have a moderate thrombocytopenia. You have LDH that is high. You have indirect bilirubin. You have D-dimer which is slightly high, but a coagulation screen which is normal. So with this kind of a picture, this can very well be a congenital TTP. Discounting, the DSDNA and anti-Smith that you talked about. The only thing is, I think his urine sediment was active or no?
Pardon?
Did he have an active urine sediment? No, right?
He had a proteinuria, not much sedimentation. Yeah, proteinuria, occult blood was positive, sorry. And he had a little class, that's it.
Okay. So congenital TTP is a definite possibility over here. Now, the other thing you can get is acquired TTP, but usually it's an acute presentation and there is some underlying condition. So this is not likely to be. And congenital TTP can have this kind of, you know, history of platelet transfusions off and on for 3 years. And typically, you know, some infection or fever triggers the need for transfusion. So that is possible. The other thing that is possible is an atypical HUS. Especially in the light of the renal, the urine picture that you mentioned. So the atypical HUS, they can also, it's an inherited defect in the complement, alternative complement pathway, and they can start off with hematological manifestations like this, and later go on to develop renal involvement. And typically they have recurrent manifestations, early onset, insidious onset. So this is another possibility, although more likely to be a congenital TTP, which you need to do ADAM TS13 mutation studies. Whereas if you are talking about atypical HUS, again, then you will have to look at the complement pathway, and there are genetic studies for the same. I would also further investigate the renal part of it, because 3+ proteinuria with casts is not very comfortable. So one would like to study that also further.
So next slide, Lekha, next slide. So basically, what Madam said is just go slow, little slow. Yeah. So what previous slide? What you said was exactly right. The ADAM TS activity, if it is deficiency, which are the predisposing factors, then you think of TTP more predominantly. Next slide. In HUS, basically what happens is when these GP3 receptors are stimulated, either because of Shiga or because of familial, the receptors are present even in the kidneys, in the brain and the liver. So therefore, this is how we explain that they are likely to have convergence. So next slide. This has already been explained by Dr. Puri. It could be ATPL. So basically, next. So what is main important is you have to see ADAM 13 activity. If it is more than 10%, think of something else. If the activity is less than 10%, then you think of either antibodies. Nowadays, we are having genetic testing. So if the antibodies are there, then you think of autoimmune or an acquired ADAM TS, and you can start with steroids. Plasma exchange would be this, the best therapy. So within 4 to 6 hours, TTP is an emergency. Within 4 to 6 hours, you are supposed to start plasma exchange with or without steroids. And if it is, this is for the diagnosis and for the treatment. Next slide. For the treatment, basically, you see for the response, if you start with the plasma exchange and then see if there is full clinical recovery, that means the platelets are more than 1.5 lakhs on at least 2 occasions, then you can say it's a full recovery. Or it can be unresponsive. The platelet count is not less. The doubling is less within the 4 days. Then you say that the response is not adequate enough. And if there is polychromasia, LDH are rising, or if there is no response. So if it is unresponsive, you can think of adding rituximab as the treatment. So by and large, 20% to 30% patients respond, but the chances of relapse are quite common. And that is why the disease has to be treated, and the genetic testing has to be thought over, and maybe you may require to do a transplant for this, but we don't have any experience about whether really transplant is indicated in such cases or not, and that is how we can think of. So next, I think that's enough for day. Back to Dr. Sunil.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sujata. I think, very common and relevant cases. Sorry, I had to duck out for a little while in between. But I think, very relevant cases. So do you have any, I just had a question. I think you mentioned antibodies in the algorithm, which we know is an important decision maker. Yeah. Are they available? Because I've tried to look for them. Are they available anywhere? Because I know the activity is being done, but not the antibodies.
No, that is what I don't even antibodies are not done, because the literature mentions, I don't know where we should just see a generalized antibodies, or now might be that you are having the probes and you could do antibodies. But in Mumbai, I had just before the lecture,
Hello.
Yeah, yeah. Has anyone else had any chance to do antibodies? Because activities, yes. We have some labs to do it. So I don't know whether Dr. Shehnaz is still on the panel. I'm not very sure whether antibodies are being done.
We had one case where we tried to do, but wasn't available. This is some time back though. Shehnaz will know probably better.
I think Shehnaz has left. She has got an emergency. So she just requested to me.
Sure.
Leave the show early. Yeah.
Okay, so thank you very much, Dr. Sujata, Dr. Rashmi, Dr. Puri, Dr. Shweta, and both the fellows, Dr. Nina and Lekha, for your presentations and lovely discussions we had. Thank you for your time, and I thank Neeta and Anand for helping with these coordinating these sessions, and Riya for the technical support. And Echo for the platform. So thank you everyone for logging in, and we'll see you next.
Yeah, actually, there were heavy rains yesterday, and there was a lot of disturbance in the connection, and that is why it caused all the problem. And it's very sorry, that was a lot of disturbance.
Absolutely fine. I think we should, Varia, we should in future, I think we should get the presentations one day in advance so that at least we can run from our side if there's a problem. Yeah.
Sure, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.